फंडिंग चेन प्रॉब्लम।
हाँ
तो फर्स्टली वी टुक ई टू द पावर आई ओमेगा टी एज आवर ट्रायल सॉल्यूशन,
करेक्ट करेक्ट
एंड आफ्टर दैट वी टुक ई टू द पावर आई के एन ए माइनस ओमेगा टी। तो
हाँ
वी टोल्ड दैट देयर इज सम फूरियर ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन वी टुक एंड आफ्टर दैट वी गॉट
Oh, so you are
दिस।
saying suppose we do a general Fourier transform, then what happens? That's what you are saying. Instead of taking a single Fourier component and using that in the solution, is that what you are saying?
I could not understand the proper way, means what we did at that point.
Ha, I understand. So see,
Yeah.
essentially, when we take the displacement of a particular ion as e to the power I omega, kx minus omega t, then we are assuming that there is a single Fourier
Okay.
component, right? And a single Fourier component is oscillating with a certain omega and a certain k, correct?
Yeah.
Whereas a general vibration, any general vibration would normally be a full, su a complete superposition of all the possible normal modes,
Yeah.
correct?
Yeah.
So the assumption here is that if you are in the thermodynamic limit, then all the Fourier components would be orthogonal to each other. Which means if you take e to the power I kx minus omega t, okay, and then you take other omegas in other case, then they would be orthogonal to each other when you integrate over x and t.
Okay.
Okay, so which means
Yeah.
that you can expand any function of x comma t in terms of omega and k. You understand? See, the
Yeah.
displacement of any particular atom is a function of space and time, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So basically what we are saying then is that that function of space and time can be expanded as a Fourier series in terms of certain normal modes of the system. You understand? So no,
Okay.
let me clarify. So you wanted to see the full derivation, correct?
Yeah, that's
Yeah.
right.
Okay, fine. So have you tried doing this by yourself?
I did it, but we will get after Fourier transform a full series, not one component.
Exactly, exactly. So you will get a whole series, but you know, in every case
Yeah.
in which such a thing happens, what you do is you take one Fourier component on one side and then multiply it to the entire series. Let us say you want to get a certain k and a certain omega, you want to isolate that. Okay?
Okay.
It's like saying that you take a superposition of orthonormal states. Okay? And then
Okay.
if you want to isolate any one component out of it, so in quantum mechanics,
Yeah.
this is easily illustrated. So you can see the screen, right? What I'm writing here?
Yeah, I can see.
Right?
Yeah.
So let us say that you had some orthonormal basis and you write the full wave function as this. Okay? So imagine now that these are
Yeah.
the phi n's that you have here are the e to the power I kx minus omega t. Okay? Of the, let's say, nth mode. Right?
Okay.
And the
Yeah.
Cn's are the coefficients, the f omega comma k. Okay?
Okay.
Which is what you don't know, but you know these functions. So this would be the analog of this, and this would be the analog of this. And now you want to extract what Cn is. Okay? So then what you would
Yeah.
do is, let's say, or some Cm. So to extract Cm, you can just do that by taking the dot product of this with this, right? That would be Cm.
Yeah.
Correct, right?
Yeah.
So this is essentially what you do for the Fourier series also. Basically, these are all orthogonal to each other. Okay? And if you, let's say, integrate e to the power I k x minus x dash, e to the power minus I omega t minus t dash, right?
Okay.
And then you integrate these over dk and d omega. Or in other words, if you had k minus k dash and omega minus omega dash, right, at a fixed x and fixed t, and then you integrate these over x and t, then these would give you delta functions.
Yeah.
So those delta functions will allow you to isolate that particular component. You
Okay.
understand? So why don't you try this out in this way? Okay? And then if you send me the notes that you have tried, then I can point out where you might have missed it. You understand what I'm saying?
So after doing this, we have to invert the series also to get the solution in the real space. Because we are solving the
Wait. So if you want a solution only in real space, then you don't need the K Fourier transform. You only need the time Fourier transform. Because in real space, you will not get the K modes. What you will get is a matrix. It's an N by N matrix if there are N atoms. Okay. And for this, when you solve the determinant of this equal to zero, right, you will get the you will get N roots for omega squared.
Yeah.
Hmm. And these N roots of omega squared will represent the N different modes.
Yeah.
But from a real space solution, you will not be able to say that these correspond to this specific K value.
Yeah, we cannot say.
So only when you do a full Fourier transform in terms of K and omega, that is when you will be able to identify that, okay, this particular omega corresponds to this particular K. And that kind of a notation, you know, that helps a lot in understanding things, and because it's going to the reciprocal space, then you can draw the dispersion there, you can draw the band structure, and neutron scattering apparently captures the dispersion in K space directly. So there are some pictures in Kittel. In fact, I might have, just one second, let me just see. Okay, now on Kittel, in the Kittel chapter on phonons, it's given how these phonon dispersions look like when observed for sodium, for example. Okay, so why don't you try that and then send me your notes.
Okay. So what I understood from this is that we will take the Fourier transform to the K space.
K space and omega space.
That will give us this delta functions. Omega space. And the coefficient.
The coefficients will basically cancel out everywhere, because you will get a single coefficient on all sides.
Okay.
Unless you have a multipoint basis. If you have a multipoint basis, then you will get the coefficients being the being different for the different inequivalent atoms. But if you have all equivalent atoms, then the coefficients will be the same. Because basically, the coefficients represent the amplitude of motion.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
So try it out, huh?
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Okay, so let's just recapitulate a little bit. What we were doing last time was a diatomic basis with periodic boundary conditions. So it's again a ring with AB, and so on. Okay, so we are again looking at a ring with a diatomic basis. So what we had done was, again, we had taken the equations of motion for these two atoms, and then we found a certain matrix. It was a 2x2 matrix. Okay, and when we solved that 2x2 matrix, we got two different solutions. So let me just write out those solutions. Omega k squared is capital K plus G by M plus or minus 1 by M square root K plus G. So these are all atoms with exactly the same mass but different spring constants. So the intra-unit cell and the inter-unit cell spring constant was supposed to be different. Okay, so that was the only thing. But the mass of these atoms is exactly the same. So you could do the same problem with the spring constant being different and the masses also being different, and you would get different dispersions. Okay, so try that out for yourself. you will see that there are some differences between the equations when you do this for different masses. Okay. In fact, we had started out, if you look at the last class notes, we had started out with two different masses, and then we specialized to the two atoms having the same mass. Okay, so you can see here that there are two roots, and there is a plus root and there is a minus root. Okay, so the plus root would obviously correspond to something which is not going to zero as k tends to zero. You can see that, because when k goes to zero, then you will get here this whole term will go to zero, and this will become k plus g whole squared. The plus root, then for k equal to zero, you are getting something finite. Okay, so the plus root corresponds to omega k squared being finite as k tends to zero, and this corresponds to omega k squared going to k squared as k tends to zero. Okay, so that you can see by doing a expansion around k tends to zero. So which means this corresponds to the acoustic mode, and this corresponds to the optical mode. Okay. All right. So and then even though we can actually plot this whole thing using some kind of a software, what we did was we looked at two different limits, the gamma point and the Brillouin zone edge. Okay, k tends to pi by a. So if you look at these two ends, then the behavior is very different, which means that if you look at the omega k plus root and the omega k minus root, then they can, you can write analytical expressions for it. Sorry, these were what we called epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. Okay. Yeah. So for the plus root, we had seen that this was twice root k plus g by m. And the minus root was square root kg by 2m k plus g times ka. Okay. And the other interesting thing about the plus root that we saw was that the epsilon 2 and epsilon 1 were exactly out of phase. Okay. And whereas for the optical, for the acoustic mode, we saw that epsilon 2 is equal to epsilon 1. Okay. So that's the interesting thing. So this is in phase. And if you plot the full dispersion, then it starts from being linear and then goes over to something finite, whereas the optical mode starts out with being flat and then ends up at something finite. Okay, so this is the plus branch and this is the minus branch. All right, so I thought at this point we can do a little bit of visualization, and I will send you a link in the chat box. So if you are not able to see on the screen, then you can look at this particular page. Let me just show you. And those who are inclined towards doing a little bit of computation, you can see that there are simple Python codes that are given here on this web page. Okay, so just take a look at this. It talks about how to visualize phonons. Okay, so in this case, for example, if you see closely, you will see that there are this entire lattice is vibrating. Okay, and this is what is called a T2G phonon. Now don't ask me where did this nomenclature come from, because I'm not a specialist in this. Prasad, are you there? Okay, Professor Vagmare is postdoc. Prasad is probably a specialist in this, and he might be able to tell us, but I don't think he has joined today. That's okay. So you can take a look at these, this code also, this software, and also at this kind of a visualization. So you can see how this entire lattice is vibrating in order to represent a single mode. Okay, and then there is one more. So if you see here, again, the same mode is represented, but using a different software. Okay, and you can see that the two adjacent atoms are vibrating in the opposite directions. Okay, but now if you look at the acoustic mode, so this is the first acoustic mode. Okay, Then if you see the kind of mode that, I mean this looks like a propagating mode. Okay, so if you see closely, this entire wave seems to be propagating across the lattice. So the neighboring atoms are moving in some sense in phase, right? They're not moving out of phase. Okay, so that's some kind of a visualization. And I have some on my notes also. So you can see here, I don't remember where I got this picture from, this gray color thing. This is from a paper, and they claim to have found chiral phonons. So you can see how these atoms are actually going around in circles. Okay, and this is another picture that I found for surface phonons, right? So you can see that the adjacent layers are moving in different directions. The bottom layer and the top layer, they are moving in opposite directions. So what the point that I wanted to make from this is that if you take a single mode, a single phonon mode, then it's not that it is localized somewhere. A single phonon mode arises through a collective motion of all the atoms in the crystal. Okay, so that is something very important to remember. And when we talk about phonons as particles, we should not imagine them to be localized somewhere. Okay? It's just a mathematical representation, and it's helpful to know that phonons can be visualized classically. Okay? And the modes that you get can be visualized classically. Of course, when you talk about the quantum nature of the phonons, then this visualization is not helpful. But still, at higher temperatures, let's say at room temperatures and so on, this visualization helps you a lot. In fact, using these kind of visualizations and also using these kind of calculations, first principles researchers have been able to pinpoint phase transitions quite accurately. Okay? So it's not, it doesn't really fail spectacularly at zero temperature. There are many situations where even this classical picture holds true, and you can do a lot of physics with these classical phonons, right? Are there any questions? No questions? Oh, by the way, Kittel has an appendix also where he claims to have done the quantum calculation for phonons, but I have not seen that. So one of you can take a look at this. And I have also put some notes in the resources drive in the folder called resources, MIT courseware notes, and there also the quantum mechanical calculation is done. But the upshot of that quantum mechanical calculation is something very simple, and that's what we will do in this class. Okay? And this will be a sort of a crash course in StatMech. Okay, for those of you who have not done StatMech. So the idea is that the Hamiltonian for the quantum mechanical phonons turns out to be the following: K and then S N K S plus half H cross omega S of K. So let me explain this. Okay, so we start from the same Hamiltonian, okay, the full Hamiltonian that we had in 3D. Right? So you will have a kinetic energy term, and you will have a potential energy term, and this potential energy could be very, very complicated. You could have, for example, multi-atom bases. You could have a full tensor for the spring constant and so on. So all of that, if you consider and then represent that in a Fourier series, okay, and then use creation annihilation operator, then it turns out that once you do all of this, then you arrive at this simple looking Hamiltonian. Okay, so this simple looking Hamiltonian has this n, the n is actually an operator here, the Hamiltonian is also an operator, and the n is given by a dagger ks a ks. This is the creation operator, this is the annihilation operator. Now the k you already know, but this S is basically the branch index. Where is the dispersion hidden? The dispersion is hidden here. So the dispersion represents the frequencies of the modes. So the, and what I had also mentioned was that when you look at the form of these modes in the quantum mechanical case or in the classical case, the form of these modes turns out to be exactly the same. They are not different at all. It's the energy eigenvalues that turn out to be very different in the classical case versus quantum case. Is this expression clear to everyone? I'm assuming that everyone has done a simple harmonic oscillator at some point, quantum mechanical, for which the Hamiltonian turns out to be n plus half h cross omega. This is called the zero point motion. Okay, this is due to the zero point motion, and these are the number of phonons or the number of quanta. So I assume that everyone is familiar with this from a first quantum mechanics class, right? And what you are seeing here is basically a generalization just of this, right? But for multiple modes. So where S represents the S represents the branch index, and the omega S of K is the dispersion. If somebody is not familiar with me, just let me know and I can give you some more references for looking this up. Okay? But you can find this, part in any basic quantum mechanics book. You can pick up Griffiths, for example, and you can look at how they derive this, right? Starting from the harmonic oscillator, a single quantum mechanical harmonic oscillator. Okay, so so from here, what we want to do is we want to look at some thermodynamic property. Okay. And to look at thermodynamic properties, statistical mechanics gives us a prescription, right? That prescription is that you find out something called a partition function. And the partition function is represented by this letter Z. And that is given by the trace of e to the power minus beta h. Okay? So let me remind you what is a trace, right? So if you take the trace is basically the sum of all diagonal elements. Okay? So why do we say this? Remember, h is a matrix. Now you will ask me, what is this a matrix in which basis is this the matrix, right? So going back to this Hamiltonian, right, this Hamiltonian will have some eigenvalues and eigenfunctions. So if I write this, then it will have En phi n. So these eigenvalues are constitute the spectrum. So if I take all the eigenvalues together, I get the spectrum. And if I take all the eigenfunctions, okay, I get the basis. Right? So in this basis, if I take all the eigenfunctions, I can always construct these matrix elements. Okay. Now if I use the diagonal basis of H, then I will get EM delta NM. Correct? So which means that all of these are eigenfunctions of the H, and they are all orthonormal to each other. Right? But if the, and this is true when phi n and phi m are themselves orthogonal. So, but if I consider some other kind of a basis, okay, so let's say I have some other basis which is not an eigen basis, then I will get the full Hamiltonian as a matrix. Okay, and in that basis, then I will have to find out all the diagonal elements and then sum them up. That is called the trace. But what are we taking the trace of here? It's a trace not just of the Hamiltonian, but it's a trace of the exponential of a Hamiltonian. Okay? So that is what a partition function is. So you have to find the exponential of a certain Hamiltonian and then take the diagonal elements and sum them up. That will give you the partition function. Okay? So with this crash course, let us now move on to how this partition function is actually calculated. Okay. So Z is trace e to the power minus beta h. And since we know that this Hamiltonian is Ks n Ks plus half h cross omega Ks, right? So each of these n values corresponds to some kind of an eigenfunction. Okay. So for those eigenfunctions, this is the energy eigenvalue. Right. So given this energy eigenvalue, we know how to construct the tower of eigenfunctions. By which, what do I mean by that? So let's take a single harmonic oscillator. Okay? Let's take n plus half h cross omega. So if I had this, this is a single quantum mechanical harmonic oscillator. If I had this Hamiltonian, then I know how to construct the psi naught. That is just given by e to the power minus x squared. Now if I take the first excited state corresponding to n equal to 1, then that corresponds, that gives us this, right? And so on. So these are the Hermite polynomials. If I take psi n, then the Hermite polynomial of x times e to the power minus x squared with some coefficients, of course. So this gives us the tower of states, the tower of states for a single quantum harmonic oscillator. Okay. And you can see here that what you have here is basically a sum of different harmonic oscillators. Okay, there is no summation here. There is no summation. So it's just this is n operator. Okay, and the eigenvalues are n plus half h cross omega. This is an operator, a dagger. Okay, so there is no summation here, but here you see there is a summation over the k and over the s, but each of these are actually independent. Okay, so in that sense, these are many different oscillators that you have here, and this is also an operator because the Hamiltonian is an operator. Okay, so to take the trace of this is very simple, because all of these are independent oscillators. I can easily take the trace over these numbers. Okay, and each of them are independent oscillators. So let's follow the calculation for a single harmonic oscillator and then generalize it to this set of harmonic oscillators. Okay, so for this, how do we proceed? We say that the Z is basically trace of e to the power minus beta h. Okay, and all we have to do here is that we have to insert the number states into this and then take a sum over that. Okay? So this is basically the sum over all the diagonal elements of the e to the power minus beta h. Okay, and then we will get e to the power minus beta n, sum over all n. So given this, now we can write down n plus half h cross omega, and you can see that there is a geometric series here, because if I take e to the power minus beta h cross omega by 2 outside, then all I will get is 1 plus e to the power minus beta h cross omega plus e to the power minus 2 beta h cross omega, and so on. Okay, so this is just a geometric series, and we can sum this up easily. Minus beta h cross omega over 1 minus e to the power minus beta h cross omega. Okay, so this can be simplified further. I'm sorry, we are going in a very strange direction. So this can be simplified as 1 over e to the power beta h cross omega by 2 minus e to the power minus beta h cross omega by 2. Okay, so if I now divide this by 2 and then multiply this by 2, this is just the sine hyperbolic function. Okay? So the partition function becomes 1 over twice sine hyperbolic of beta h cross omega by 2. Okay? So you can write this in a very simple way, that the partition function for a single quantum mechanical harmonic oscillator is given by this. Okay? So it's an exactly solvable problem. Now looking at this, okay, looking at this Hamiltonian, this looks a little bit more complicated because we are summing over all the different momenta, and you're also summing over the different branches. But the nice thing to see is that all of these K and all of these branch indices are independent of each other. Okay, and because they're independent of each other, the full partition function turns out to be just the product over all the momenta and the branches of a single partition function. Okay, so because of this, we can utilize the derivation that we had done for a single.
Sir?
Yeah.
Here in simple harmonic oscillator, there is only one frequency, but frequency is independent. But when we take the system of phonons, the frequency is function of K also, and we are also summing over K. So how can we just simply multiply all the single harmonic partition function? That is, so I am asking this.
Sure. Yeah, let me explain that then. So you are having trouble with this expression, correct? This Z is equal to product over all Ks of the single ZKs, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So to explain that, so let's write this, okay? So the H is basically sum over all Ks of the Hamiltonian for a single K and a single S. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. So this, and let me explicitly say that these are all operators. Fine. So if the H hat KS for a single K and for a single branch is given by N hat KS plus half times H cross omega S K. This is okay, right?
Okay, sir. That means at a particular K and particular branch, all the particular K and particular branch are mutually independent, and
exactly.
We are multiplying.
So you can express that in a different way also. What you can see is that if I take HKS, okay, and try to commute that with a different branch or a different
delta
momentum, right?
Delta
then
KS.
You would get a delta KK dash delta S.
Delta S is there. Okay.
Because these all Hamiltonians commute with each other for different branch and different branch index, when you exponentiate it, right? When you exponentiate it, it basically splits into all the different Hamiltonians. So what we are saying is e to the power minus beta h hat will be e to the power minus beta sum over ks h hat ks. Okay. And
okay,
you take e to the power a plus b, where a and b are operators, okay, then you can write this as e to the power a and e to the power b only when a and b commute with each other. Okay, otherwise you cannot split this, right? So this is not true if a and b don't commute with each other, right? There are other terms that come in. There is an infinite series that comes in the most general case. Okay, so in this case, what we can do is we can immediately write e to the power minus beta h k1 s1, e to the power minus beta h k2 s2, and so on. If there are n modes. Okay, so in this case, then you can see that you have got a product of the different exponentials. And that's why we can write product over all k and s of e to the power minus beta h k s. Okay.
Sir,
yes.
Is it possible for the system to have interactions such that the Hamiltonian cannot be written in this term?
Absolutely, yes. In fact, if you look at the anharmonic interactions, then what happens is you can't even write the Hamiltonian in this form. Okay, in the anharmonic case, what you will get is the different phonon modes will start interacting with each other. Okay, so the way we have written here, AKS dagger AKS plus half, okay, this is just the diagonal part.
So in that case, can we say that all these will be the energy states, and the term which I am adding, that anharmonic term, can be considered to be as perturbation, which will simply make transition between different states?
That's a very good visualization. In fact, that is what mostly is done. So let's say if you look at the scattering term, then you could have terms which look like AKS dagger, AK plus Q, S dash, right? So with some particular Ks, K dash, S dash. So there is some amplitude for hopping or for the phonons to go from a K to K plus Q and S to S dash. In fact, this is a quadratic term because this has only two operators. You could have, for example, A. So you could have A dagger, A kind of terms. You could even have, because these are phonons, you could have terms which even violate the number conservation. Okay. So because phonons do not conserve number. So in such cases, as you said, you can assume that the coefficients here small, right? And you can do a perturbation series. And this diagonal Hamiltonian gives you the basis, or it gives you the energy states. And these perturbing terms are causing excitations or transitions between these energy states. Sure. In fact, if you look at the labels that we are using, right, the K and the S labels, they come from the diagonal Hamiltonian. And because we are saying that K to K plus Q, we are in some sense actually referring to the basis states and saying that there is a transition from one basis state to the next basis state. Okay. So this is a very general principle. In fact, that is what is done in most of interacting systems. You start with the diagonal part, which is solvable exactly. You get the basis from that diagonal part. And then you solve the interacting problem, the full interacting problem, by writing down a wave function in terms of the diagonal basis. Okay. In fact, if you look at the entire density functional theory, then that is also built on the same principle. Because if you read literature on DFT, you will see there is something called a plane wave basis. Okay. Or you would see something like a muffin tin orbital basis. Or you might see something like augmented plane wave basis. So basically what these basis functions are doing is that you have some diagonal part and you would have solved that and you would have got a basis. Okay. Now plane wave basis is the basis for free electrons. Muffin tin orbitals similarly are basis for localized electrons. Augmented plane wave is again got by doing an augmentation of the plane wave. So this is a basis where you say, okay, I know the problem that I'm solving. It's an exactly solvable problem. It's a non-interacting problem. I solve that exactly. And then the interactions for the full interacting problem, I write down a wave function, which is a superposition of the basis states. So yes, that's exactly what happens when you do an interacting problem. Okay.
And sir, what will happen when the system becomes strongly interacting such that I can't take the part of the Hamiltonian as a perturbation?
Good. A very logical conclusion to this. So it turns out that perturbation theory definitely is not valid. And you have to use methods like renormalization group. Even in perturbation theory, there is something called a Borel summation. Okay. So it's a quantum unibody technique. And using this Borel summation, one takes these diagrams, Feynman diagrams, which in fact, if you go to higher and higher order in perturbation series, they keep on increasing. Okay, because you can expect that if the term is not perturbative, then you have to do an infinite order resummation of the diagrams, of the Feynman diagrams. But that infinite order resummation involves pretty complicated techniques. So one can do things like that. But there are other things called quantum Monte Carlo. Okay. Then there are things called renormalization group techniques. Okay. So functional integration techniques. So there are other techniques which are non-perturbative. And one has to employ non-perturbative techniques if the anharmonicity or these off-diagonal terms become very strong. So that's what has to be done. And in fact, there are cases where in the electronic systems, it's very, very common to see the off-diagonal terms becoming extremely strong, and you have to employ non-perturbative techniques. In fact, not just strong. So you can imagine that suppose there is a term, suppose there is a Hamiltonian where there are two terms, okay, H1 and H2, and the H1 and H2 don't commute with each other. Right? If they don't commute with each other, then it's impossible to find a common basis for the two to be diagonal. Right? So you will diagonalize one of the Hamiltonians, and then you will say that let me work in this basis to solve this full problem. But then if you find that this coupling constant here in front of the other term becomes of the order of 1, which is the coefficient here, right? even then the problem becomes non-perturbative. So if there are two parts in the Hamiltonian which are non-commuting, and the coefficients of those two Hamiltonians become of the order of each other, then the problem is non-perturbative. And you really have to, you know, apply non-perturbative techniques in order to solve the entire problem. Yeah, it's a whole new game. Yes.
And sir, how do we know that the system I am having will have some strong interactions or weak interactions?
Again, yeah, it's a very good question. There are back of the envelope calculations that one can do in order to figure that out. Okay. See, I will give you one example, and I'm sorry for this digression, but I think most of you will also relate to this, okay, or at least see this as an interesting thing. Suppose I take a box, okay, and assume that in this box I am filling up the entire box with some positive charge which is smeared out. Okay, so in some sense, take a crystal, and instead of putting these ions at fixed places, assume that I smear them out. Okay? And I smear them out in such a way that this full box contains the positive charge. And in this smeared out positive charge, I introduce electrons. Okay? And this model, where the electrons are floating around in a background of positive charge, is called the Jellium model. Okay, so it's a very useful model, because the Jellium model has been used for computing a lot of exchange correlation functionals for density functional theory, which is used for first principles calculations. Okay, so even though this is this looks like a really toy model, because you're not taking into account any of the lattice structure, right? And you're basically saying that the entire positive charge is like a jelly which is spread out throughout the crystal. Now, in this system, how do you know whether the electrons are strongly interacting or weakly interacting? Okay, see, remember, the electrons here, they have negative charges. Okay, and if I want to write down the full Hamiltonian of the system, it turns out that you will get a term which looks like just the kinetic energy. Okay, so in fact, I can write that as AK dagger AK with a K squared sum over K. Then there is another term which looks like 4 pi by q squared a k plus q dagger a p minus q dagger a p, okay, some more k p q, and q is not zero. Now here there is a coefficient. So you see that this is a problem where this is a diagonal part, because this is just the number operator, but here you see transitions. Okay, the p is going to p minus q and the k is going to k plus q. Okay, so you can represent this using this kind of a diagram. Now, how do you know a priori, that's your question, that this term is small or large? Isn't that your question?
Yes, sir.
So even before solving the problem, how do I know whether perturbation theory will be valid or not? Okay. So it's a extremely difficult question. Only in certain problems we know the answer beforehand, and in many other problems, in fact, it has turned out that people have done perturbation theory just because they could do it, but later on it was found that the problem is totally non-perturbative, and if you apply perturbation theory, one can fail spectacularly. Okay, so in this particular example, let me tell you what is it that controls the strength of the interaction. It turns out there is a parameter called RS, okay, which is sitting here, and this RS turns out to depend on the density of electrons which is present in the crystal. Okay, now I want to ask you a question, okay, which will illustrate the difficulty of the situation. If I had a high density of electrons versus a low density of electrons, okay? So imagine a high density versus a low density. What do you think, in which situation would the system of electrons be strongly interacting, which means the strength of this term would be very large, and in which situation the interacting term would be considered a perturbation? What do you think?
I think the high density one will be of more more interactions.
So you think that high density will be strongly interacting, correct?
Yes.
Good. You did not fall into the trap. Which means that you followed your intuition. Okay. And high density, we think that all the electrons are very close to each other. And because the Coulomb interaction falls off as 1 by R, so because the R is small, the interaction will be large. Correct, right? That's the logic?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Good. So it turns out in this problem, this logic fails. Okay. So it turns out this RS is a parameter which is in fact inversely proportional to the density. And why is that? It turns out that the high density of electrons is actually a weakly interacting system. And the reason is that for a high density of electrons, there is a large amount of screening that happens. Okay, so there is a many body phenomenon that happens here, a quantum many body phenomenon called screening. Okay, so even before you solve the problem, you can see that for a high density of electrons, you get this parameter to be much smaller, whereas for a low density of electrons, this parameter RS turns out to be very large. Okay, and it has been found through numerical calculations, because analytical calculations are not possible in this limit, that in this limit the electrons form a Wigner crystal. You remember I was talking about the phase transitions of electrons, right?
Yes, sir.
In the limit when RS is zero, you will actually get a gas. This is a gas of electrons. If you turn on RS and make it small, you will get a liquid of electrons. That's called a Fermi liquid. If you make RS very, very large, which means a very low density of electrons, you will get a solid of electrons, where the electrons occupy fixed positions, of course, with zero point motion. But this solid of crystals is called the Wigner crystal. And this crystal has nothing to do with the underlying lattice parameter of the crystal that you are considering. Okay, so in this problem, even though it's very counterintuitive, and to know more about this, I give an advanced solid state physics course, but you can also look at books like Fetter and Waleka and many other places where the Jellium model has been solved, and there the entire thing is very well laid out. Okay, so you can do a simple dimensional analysis to see what is the value of RS and how does it depend on density. Okay, so in this problem, it's straightforward to figure out the parameters within which perturbation theory will work and parameters within which perturbation theory will fail. Now, if you consider the problem of electrons and phonons, it turns out their perturbation theory fails spectacularly. Okay, especially if you want to consider the problem of superconductivity. So, how do we know that? Okay. So it turns out the transition temperature of superconductors is proportional to e to the power minus 1 over g in some dimensionless units, where this g is an electron phonon coupling. Now, why do I say that this is non-perturbative? So try expanding this function as a Taylor series in g. Okay, so e to the power minus 1 by x does not have a Taylor series about x is equal to 0. The reason is, for x is equal to 0, this has an essential singularity. Do you see the point that this is an essential singularity? Because x is equal to 0, this will actually blow up on one side and this will go to 0 on the other side. Okay? Hello?
Can you please explain?
Yeah, so I was saying that this function has an essential singularity at x is equal to 0. Do you see that? Because as x tends to 0 plus, if you take x tends to 0 plus, then e to the power minus 1 over 0 plus will give you 0.
Yes.
Okay. But as x tends to 0 minus, you can see that this will be negative, but very, very small. Okay. So this e to the power minus 1 by x will blow up.
Yes.
Okay, so this function in fact looks very, very strange, and if you try to plot this, it will look like this on the positive side, but on the negative side it blows up. Okay, so it has an essential singularity at x is equal to 0, which means you cannot do a Taylor series about x is equal to 0. Okay, and what you're doing in a perturbation theory is actually a Taylor series, nothing more than that. Okay, so in fact, if you do a perturbation theory, then the series has to be convergent, right? Only then the perturbation theory is valid. So what I was saying is that in superconductivity, the transition temperature turns out to have an essential singularity at zero electron phonon coupling, which means you cannot do a Taylor's expansion about G equal to zero. And in terms of electron phonon coupling, the problem is non-perturbative. Okay, and there are multiple such situations where only after you solve the problem, you find out that the problem is non-perturbative. Okay, and there are very few problems where you know beforehand that perturbation theory will be okay. So these are very difficult questions, and only after a lot of experience in the field, you will find out, whichever field you are in, you will find out which problems are perturbative, which problems are non-perturbative, and so on. So there is no empirical rule to figure out really, okay, for any new problem. It's on a case by case basis. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Yeah, it's okay. Clear now.
Okay, so yeah, so we were doing this problem, nks plus half h cross omega ks. So is that we can write this as a sum of different Hamiltonians which all commute with each other, and this is the number operator, and the number operator is such that if I operate this on any state, right, I will get just the number of the phonons in that particular state. So given this, what I can do is I can sandwich this Hamiltonian in between these states, and then because I know that in this basis the Hamiltonian is diagonal, I can follow exactly the same prescription that I followed for a single harmonic oscillator. Okay? So from that I can find out the partition function, and it will just turn out to be a product of the partition functions for each Ks. Okay, and that can be written very simply, which is product over all Ks of 1 over e to the power beta h cross omega Ks by 2 minus s by 2. Okay. So this partition function can be found, and for finding, so remember we were after finding the, I mean we wanted to find the the specific heat, right? So the specific heat can be defined as del E by del T. So this is the internal energy. So remember, we are not looking at the free energy, okay? So we are looking at just the internal energy, which means this is just the CV, okay? So the internal energy can be found out by looking at the expectation value of the Hamiltonian. Now, what is the Hamiltonian? It's given there. So the expectation value of the Hamiltonian will turn out to be just the expectation value of the number operator, because there is nothing, I mean, there is no other operator in this whole equation. This is the only operator. Now, to find the expectation value of the number operator, we go back to the partition function. Okay. Excuse me. So, to understand this, let me just take the example again of a single harmonic oscillator. This is the single harmonic oscillator, and the partition function is just trace of e to the power minus beta n hat plus half h cross omega. So if I take this as the partition function, then for this particular state, I know that there are n phonons in this state. Okay, so to find the expectation value of n, or let's say the number operator, what do? I take n and then multiply here with n, e to the power minus beta n plus half h cross omega, and then divide it by the partition function. Okay? So this comes from saying that if I want to take any expectation value, then I should substitute this here and then do this. So see, I don't know how many of you are familiar with this formalism. I have been using this formalism quite a bit. So please do let me know if at any stage you don't find, you find any formula to be unfamiliar to you. Okay, I can explain that. Is this all clear to everyone? There's a lot of statmec that is being used here, okay? We are in the canonical ensemble.
Yes, sir.
So, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and this trace part is a little bit confusing for me. Like we are taking okay. trace of...
Okay, fine. Sure. So as I explained before also, if I want to take the trace of some matrix A, okay? So trace is usually taken for a matrix, isn't it? You know that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So how is a trace defined? It's a sum of all the diagonal elements, correct?
Yeah.
So the partition function is defined as the trace of another matrix, which is exponential of minus beta H. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. So now how to take the trace of this? Remember, the H is an operator. Right. So what do I have to do? I have to find out a basis, okay, and then express this Hamiltonian in that basis, construct the Hamiltonian matrix, okay, and once I construct the Hamiltonian matrix, then I can take all the diagonal elements and then sum them up, okay. Just give me 1 minute. Yeah. So Krishna, is this step clear, that we are taking the trace of e to the power minus beta h, and how do we take this? We have to construct the Hamiltonian as a matrix and then take all the diagonal elements. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now the Hamiltonian could have two parts: one which is, let's say, exactly solvable, and the other which need not be exactly solvable. Okay, like for example, the harmonic oscillator part, and this could be the enharmonicity, or this could be non-interacting electrons, this could be the interactions, or this could be electrons plus phonons, and this could be the electron phonon interaction. Then you take this part which is exactly solvable, and you find out all the different states, the eigenstates. Okay, this set of eigenstates can now be used for finding the full Hamiltonian as a matrix. How do you do that? You say that the nm element of this Hamiltonian matrix is basically nhm. Okay? And then for this nm, then you sandwich this h1 plus h2 within this h1 hat plus h2 hat. And what you find is that this H1 will immediately give you the eigenvalue, but the other part will be off-diagonal. H2 hat will have some off-diagonal entry because the H2 hat is not diagonal in that basis. Okay? So using this prescription, you can actually construct any Hamiltonian matrix. Now, what you have to do here is that you have to exponentiate that matrix, which means you have to take the full series of 1 minus beta h plus minus beta h whole squared by 2 and so on, the exponential series, find it to infinite number of infinite order, and then take the trace of every element in that series. Okay, it's a very difficult challenge. If you have an off-diagonal Hamiltonian, it's not easy at all. Do you know how to take the trace of any of the exponential of a or do you know how to take the exponential of any matrix? I think you might have been asked this question in the PhD interviews, no? Were you asked?
No, sir, I have not been asked it.
Okay, you missed that. I see. That's a favorite question, okay, yeah, in PhD interviews. So I'll give you a poly matrix. Okay. So let's call it sigma x, and sigma x, you know, is 0, 1, 1, 0, right? Huh? So how will you find e to the power alpha sigma x? So this is pretty simple, because it turns out that if you square the poly matrix, it turns out to be the identity. Okay. But if you take a general matrix, then you have to do a similarity transformation or a unitary transformation, diagonalize this, and then for the diagonal matrix, the exponentiation is very simple. And then you do the inverse unitary transformation. Okay, so that's how you find the exponential of any general matrix. So that's what one has to do here. Okay. So the trace now means that you have to take some basis and then find out e to the power minus beta h in that basis, and then do a sum over n. That's what this means. Is this clear? Krishna?
Yeah.
Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So you will, I guess you will be doing the StatMed course next semester. So you will see more about this. But this is specific to the quantum mechanical part. In the classical part, you take the trace in a different way. Okay. See, if you are Hamiltonian, let's say it depends on some variables like P and Q for the classical case. Okay. Then what you do is e to the power minus beta, you take an integral over all the dynamical variables, integral dp, integral dq. Okay. So that's how the classical trace is taken. In the quantum mechanical case, you take the trace over the basis states. So that's what is done here. Okay. Is that fine?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So let me just rub this off, because I need this partition function expression. So the idea here is that if I want to find out the internal energy, then to find the internal energy, I need the expectation value of the number operator. And to find the expectation value of the number operator, I have to use this particular expression, where the expectation value of the number operator is basically taking the number for every state, okay, then taking the weight for every state, and then dividing it by the partition function. So we are saying that you take each number, you multiply it with the weight. Okay, this is the weight corresponding to every state, or the probability of every state, and then you divide it by the full partition function. So if you do this, not surprisingly, what you will find is this e to the power beta h cross omega minus 1. Okay, so this is basically n. Now you will recognize that this is basically the Bose-Einstein distribution function. Okay, so for the quantum mechanical harmonic oscillator, if you want to find out the expectation value of the nth state, then it turns out to be 1 over e to the power h cross omega by kbt minus 1. Okay, so this is also known as the nb of omega. This is the Bose-Einstein distribution, e to the power beta h cross omega minus 1 inverse. Well, I have not defined beta here. So for those of you again who have not done the StatMech course, beta is 1 over KBT. So the temperature enters in that way. Okay. So from here we can find out we know the N. So we can substitute the N into this internal energy expression. And once we substitute that, we can see that temperature has entered in this expression through the Bose-Einstein distribution function. Okay. And once we know this internal energy as a function of temperature, we can take a derivative with respect to temperature of that and then get the specific heat. Okay, so that's basically the plan. Let me write it out once again. So what we are doing is we are taking CV as del of the expectation value with respect to temperature, and this turns out to be sum over KS of nks expectation value plus half times h cross omega ks. Okay, so that's what we have to do. And then if we, by using the partition function, we have found out the expectation value of the number corresponding to the momentum k and the branch s, it will be the Bose-Einstein distribution function, which is this. So if we take this and then substitute this here and then take a derivative with respect to temperature, we will get the specific heat as a function of temperature. That is the idea. Okay, so is this plan clear to everyone? See, there is a lot of algebra that one has to do here, but if you do that algebra, then this is the how to do that algebra is basically in this way that I pointed out. Okay. Is this clear to everyone? I mean, if it is not clear, just let me know now. See, I see a lot of people who don't speak anything. There are usual suspects who always ask questions, and that's very nice. That keeps the class lively and interactive. But there are many people who never ask any question. They don't speak in the class. If this was an actual physical class, I would be actually pointing towards people and then asking them so that they also, you know, get out of their slumber. But in this online class, I don't see anyone. I actually see the sketchboard, right? So it becomes very difficult. But please don't feel shy. Just ask questions. Okay. All right, so with this prescription, then we can find out what the specific heat looks like. So let me write down that expression. It's a little bit of a big expression, so let me write that. Turns out to be this: kBT squared 1 over the volume sum over all k and s h cross omega ks whole squared divided by e to the power beta h cross omega ks minus 1 whole squared. Okay, so this is the expression for the specific heat as a function of temperature. All right, so this is supposed to be valid at all temperatures. And remember, this is the exact solution for a system of for a monoatomic lattice, okay, in any dimension, right? And it's supposed to be valid at all temperatures, and it's an exact solution, okay, of a coupled harmonic oscillator system. So that's really impressive. But for this, the omega ks is something that you have to find out from a different method. Okay, so you have to do the Fourier transform, and by doing the Fourier transform and then transforming to different coordinates, the creation annihilation coordinates, that is when you will get the dispersion. Okay, so that if you are given, then this turns out to be the full exact solution for the specific heat as a function of temperature. Okay, now from this we will try to see what is the behavior of this coupled harmonic oscillator system at low temperatures and high temperatures. Okay, so that's what we want to see. Now, naively, if you look at this, as T tends to 0, there is a 1 over T squared which is sitting here. Okay, so 1 by T squared tends to infinity. So naively, one would think that because the T tends to 0 and 1 by T squared goes to infinity, the CV might actually go to infinity. Okay, but this logic does not seem to be correct. It turns out that there are exponentials which are sitting here. Okay, and these exponentials actually kill the T squared divergence, and make the CV go as T cube. So let us see how that happens. Okay, to see that, we have to see what happens when e to the power beta h cross omega ks, how does this behave for extremely small beta. Okay, so that's what we have to see. But the low temperature limit is a little bit more complicated. So let's first look at the high temperature limit. Because for the low temperature limit, in fact, I will be asking you that question. Okay, we will make an approximation here in the high temperature limit, and I will ask you, why does that approximation break down when we go to the low temperature limit? So let's see. So for the high temperature limit, it means T tends to, T is much larger, okay? But then the question is, it's much larger compared to what? So can somebody point out here, what should this T be large compared to?
H cross omega by k, something, the energy of H cross omega.
H cross omega ks.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, but then, see, you see that there is, that's good. But then you see there is a sum over ks, right?
K factor, yeah.
So which k is like it?
At large k, it will, at small k, the kBT will be larger than h cut k, omega ks. And at high k value, the kBT value will not be greater than h cut omega ks.
So you are saying that kBT will lie somewhere in between the h cross omega k, where k tends to 0, and h cross omega k when k is large. Is that right? Are you saying that? Are you saying this?
Hello? Yes, sir.
Can you hear me?
Sir.
Yeah?
Yes, sir.
So you are saying kBT will lie in between these two, correct?
Yeah.
But can I not consider a temperature which lies here? So you remember the dispersion of the phonons was something like this, right? Okay. So, in fact, what is the maximum energy of the phonons? It's this, isn't it? See, this is the minimum energy and this is the maximum energy, okay? What if I consider a kBT which is here? Or not even here, but somewhere here. Can I not consider that?
Yeah, I can.
So, what we are now going to do is that we are going to take the maximum, okay, of the h cross omega ks. It's a maximum over all momenta and over all the branches in the system, right? So the temperature has been chosen in such a way that the thermal energy is much greater than the maximum of any phonon frequency in the system, okay? So in this limit, what happens to e to the power h cross omega ks by kBT? The thermal energy is much larger compared to this, which means that I can write down a Taylor series for this and retain only the linear term. Okay. So if I do this, you will immediately see that e to the power beta h cross omega ks minus 1 becomes just h cross omega ks by kBT. Okay. And there is a squared here. So this also becomes 1 plus h cross omega ks by kBT. Okay. So what you will see is that from the numerator, you will get h cross omega k squared. In the denominator, you will get h cross omega ks by kBT whole squared. And this e to the power beta h cross omega ks is 1 plus some small number. Okay. And there is a 1 by t squared, which is sitting outside. This t squared is going to cancel this t squared. Right. And this whole thing becomes a constant. Okay, so the specific heat at the thermal energy is much greater than any phonon frequency, the specific heat turns out to be a constant. Constant with respect to temperature. Okay, so that is very significant because that's what the classical result is. The classical result obtained using the equipartition theorem tells you that the specific heat is actually a constant at high temperatures. Do you agree with this?
Yeah.
So if you do the detailed calculation, in fact, you can show that the classical result is exactly obtained. Okay. So you will see that the specific heat turns out to be equal to 3NKB, where N is the number of modes, divided by the volume. Okay. So it's exactly 3NKB. Right? And in fact, you can also find out the higher order corrections coming from this. And what you will find is that it's something like this, something by T squared. It's 1 over T squared correction. Okay. So this result, which is derived using quantum mechanics, gives you the Bose-Einstein distribution. but then it reproduces the classical result at high temperatures. And what is that high temperature? That temperature is such that it is greater than, much greater than the maximum of all phonon frequencies in the system. Okay. So now let's look at the low temperatures. Okay, I will have to write down that expression once again. It's a big expression. Cv is 1 over kBT squared 1 by V. Sorry, I shouldn't have deleted this, but I don't know how to delete selectively on this page. I have to delete either the entire page, or I have to use that eraser, which is very, very slow. Okay, so for the high temperature limit, we had assumed that KBT is much greater than H cross omega KS. Okay, so this is the high temperature limit. Obviously for the low temperature limit, we should be saying that KBT is much smaller than H cross omega KS. Okay, but this cannot be implemented. So I'm giving you the answer that this low temperature limit cannot be implemented as an approximation in this specific heat expression. Now I want to know from you why. Why can I not use, or why can I not be at a temperature which is much smaller than the phonon energies?
The minimum energy of phonon is zero. We can attain zero energy.
Exactly. So the minimum of H cross omega KS. So in fact, if we look at the high temperature limit, then we had said that the KBT has to be much greater than the maximum of H cross omega KS. So here also, we should be looking at KBT much smaller than the minimum of H cross omega KS to be in the low temperature limit. But we know that for acoustic phonons, omega KS tends to zero for acoustic long wavelength phonons. Okay, so since it goes to zero, there is no temperature which would be considered low temperature except zero temperature, right? So to do the low temperature limit, you have to be extremely, extremely careful. Okay, and what one has to do is one has to do this K summation in an approximate way by choosing an appropriate dispersion. Okay, so what one can do is, let's consider acoustic phonons first. So for acoustic phonons, it turns out to have a and for optical phonons, it turns out to have a different expression. So for optical phonons, can I make this approximation?
Yes,
right? Because optical phonons do have a minimum which is finite, which is not zero. Okay, so if I make this approximation, KBT is much smaller than the minimum of H cross omega KS, then this is fine. Okay, but for acoustic phonons, this is not correct. Okay, so for acoustic phonons, what I have to do is I have to assume some sort of a dispersion. So let's call it CK. Okay, now this would obviously be very complicated in real systems. The C itself will depend on some direction. It will be a tensor in the most general case, and and so on. And this will not be just mod K. Okay, there will be some dependence also in this. There could be anisotropy in the system and so on. Okay, but in any case, they will be linear, right? So the simplest possible case in which this is linear is just taking a constant here instead of a tensor and mod K here. Okay. So if I take this kind of an expression and then substitute that for the specific heat, what I will get is the following. Let me write that: KBT squared 1 by V, then V by 8 pi Q. I'll explain this in a moment. So let me take three dimensions, okay? And for three dimensions, the sum over K can be replaced by an integral over dKx, dKy, dKz with 2 pi by L. 2 pi by L. Okay, and this is what gives you integral over dk and then v over 8 pi q. So this is what we have used to convert this summation into an integral. Okay, so this integral is now over h cross c k whole squared e to the power beta h cross c k divided by e to the power beta h cross c k minus 1 whole squared. Again, this is a very, very complicated integral. Okay, but what you can do is express the dk here in spherical polar coordinates, 4 pi k squared dk. And the reason you can do that is because this entire argument here of the integral depends only on the mod k, right? So if you do that, then it turns out that the 4 pi k squared dk and so on, you can make a simple substitution. Okay, and remember the k here goes from all the way from 0 to some k max. Now what that k max is something very is not known a priori. In the sense, see, we are taking a linear dispersion, but we know that acoustic phonons do not have a linear dispersion for all k. Okay, in fact, if I take the linear dispersion, then the linear dispersion breaks down somewhere here, even in the middle of the Brillouin zone, right? So what is the justification in taking a linear dispersion all the way to some k max, right? So the idea is that that is where the Debye theory enters. Okay, but let me go into that a little bit later. But before we do that, let's assume that there is some k max up to which you can do this, okay? And then you can make simple substitutions. And what then happens is that you will get a h cross c k max divided by kbt. And this can always be chosen to be much greater than 1. So the thermal energy can be chosen to be much smaller compared to this energy scale, h cross c times k max. Okay, and when you do that, this upper limit of the integral tends to infinity. Okay, so there is again a lot of algebra in this step, but it's not very hard to see. Okay, it's just a little bit tedious. And I'm in two minds whether to do that whole thing or not. Okay, let me just do this. So CV is 1 over KBT squared, 1 over V by 8 pi cube, integral over dk.
Sir?
Yeah?
Sir, you told that this integration should be from 0 to some maximum value of k. Now, the Debye theory is... it should be connected to the frequency. So if we don't know the dispersion relation, so how can we say that about the k max, or what will be the raised value of the k's?
Correct.
That means 0 to k max, and from the other values of k that belongs to the Birula zone, the k max to Birula zone k value. So what will be that part?
So are you asking, so if I rephrase your question, are you asking how do I find the k max?
No, sir. The integration is from 0 to some maximum value. So,
ideally, what I should be doing is that if I want to find it for acoustic phonons, I should be taking omega k to be equal to that 4 k by m mod sine k a by 2. Do you agree?
Yeah.
But, and this is, if you remember, this is true only for one dimension. Now, if I'm doing higher dimensions, then the dispersion is not so simple. In fact, the dispersion turns out to be sine squared kx a by 2 plus sine squared ky a by 2 plus sine squared kz a by 2. And that is also when all the directions are independent. The spring constants are all independent in the different directions, and it's a cubic crystal. Okay, so for this dispersion, if you supply this dispersion to this integral, you cannot solve anything analytically. Okay, All we are doing is we are making some very, very simple approximations in order to figure out what happens to the temperature dependence at extremely low temperatures. Is that okay?
Okay.
So this is not a realistic calculation at all. Definitely not. And it is definitely a toy calculation because we are assuming a linear dispersion and the linear dispersion breaks down. So as I was saying, even in the middle of the Brillouin zone, okay, it in fact becomes flat here, right? And the full sine Ka has to be taken. Okay. So this is obviously a very big approximation that we have made here. And then if we simplify this further, then we will get 1 over 8 pi cube, 1 over kbt squared, and then 4 pi will come out from here, integral dk times k squared. And then the h cross ck, if you look at this h cross ck and then there is a beta also, you can say, you can make a substitution of this kind, okay, that x is h cross ck by kbt, right? So if you do that, then here this can be replaced by x squared if you divide it by h cross c by kbt whole squared, and from here another will come and this will also become x, right? This becomes e to the power x over e to the power x minus 1 whole squared, where x goes from 0 to h cross c k max by kbt. Okay, so what has been done here is the following. If I simplify this further, I will get 1 over 2 pi squared, 1 over kbt squared, and have I missed something? Yeah, I missed something. There's a k squared. Oh yeah, sorry. There is a k squared here and the dk also has a k squared. So there is actually an x to the power 4 here. And this will become to the power 5. So is this counting clear? Because this counting is really crucial. Okay, where does this 5 come from and where does this 4 come from? So just convince yourself that there is a k squared that is sitting here, okay, and there is a k squared that is sitting here, and there is a dk also. There is a k squared times dk. So when you make all the this substitution, x is equal to h cross c k by kbt, then you will get h cross c by kbt to the power 5 in the denominator. Okay, and that is crucial because you will see that the cv going as t cube arises from this particular argument. Okay. So 1 by kbt squared, and then if I take this out of this integral, I will get kbt divided by h cross c whole to the power 5 integral dx x to the power 4 e to the power x divided by e to the power x minus 1 whole squared. And the limits are 0 to some x max, and where the x max is given by h cross c k max by kbt. Now if we restrict ourselves to temperatures which are much smaller compared to this energy scale, right, then this x max becomes much greater than 1, and in the limit that x max becomes much greater than 1, we can take this integral or this upper limit to be infinity. Okay, that is again an ideal or a toy calculation. So in which case this entire integral becomes independent of temperature and it becomes just a number, because you can see inside there is no h cross, there is no c, there is no k, right? It's just a pure integral and it becomes just a number, which means now we can simplify this, and you can see there is a t to the power 5 here, there is a t squared here. So this goes as some number times t cube. Okay, so this was the result that we wanted to achieve, that what is the low temperature behavior of specific heat for a coupled harmonic oscillator system. Okay, and this is, remember, only for the acoustic branch, because we took the linear dispersion, right? If the if you take the optical branch, you will actually see a exponential contribution, right? So this is for optical phonons. And again, the calculation for this is very simple. You can try to do this yourself. But if not, we will do this in the next class. So this is only for the acoustic branch. So the CV goes as T cube at very low temperatures. And at high temperatures, it saturates to a constant value. Okay? So it's T cube here, and then it saturates to 3N kBT. And the optical phonons do something different. They are exponentially small here, but then they rise up and then follow the same classical law. Okay? And understanding this is again not difficult. See, if you supply any heat to the system, then you will excite the atoms. Okay, the atoms will start vibrating about their equilibrium positions. But then which phonons can you excite at extremely low temperatures? You can only excite acoustic phonons because their energies are very, very small. Optical phonons have a finite energy, which means unless you reach that particular temperature, you will not be able to excite those phonons properly. Okay, there will always be some quantum mechanical probability of exciting those phonons, but it will be exponentially small. Right? So at very low temperatures, the optical phonons will not absorb any of the energy that you will be supplying. Okay, and that's why you get the specific heat to be exponentially small. Alright, so we will stop here, and then in the next class we will take up the optical phonons. And then also look at some other considerations. For example, density of states, we will look at that. And we will also look at the Debye theory. And then we'll look at the enharmonic term also. What is the contribution of the enharmonic term? And how do you explain the displacement from equilibrium? A plastic displacement, okay, not an elastic displacement. So, right, my throat is gone. Okay, so are there any questions?
Sir, the phonons are bosons. So what will be the spin of the phonons?
So there is no spin of the bosons. I mean, the phonons in this case have a spin zero. But there is something else. You saw that there is a polarization. There is a branch index. Okay. And that branch index is actually... Okay, so the branch index should not be thought of as a spin. But these phonons turns out to have spin zero. These are spin zero phonons.
How was it known that the phonons have spin zero?
How is it known? Okay.
Because it is an intrinsic property.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So how do we know?
Yeah, I don't know the answer. I'm not sure exactly how we can say that phonons have spin zero. Let me think about it and find out the answer.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Other questions? I will note down that question. So, I don't think there are other questions. So, let me close this here. And I'll see
you. Video recording.
Yeah, I think Saptarishi is doing it. So, and thanks Saptarishi. So, I guess he's also a busy guy, and maybe he's finding some difficulty in recording or putting them on YouTube. That's all. Huh. Oh, okay. Yeah, see, what I told Saptarishi was that we can trim the frame. Okay, we can trim the frame of the lectures so that only the sketchboard is available, is visible on the screen. And also we can clip certain parts where, for example, initially there is people are still entering and so on. So we can clip those parts also. So sorry, I have not been able to talk to the audiovisual team. In fact, I spoke to them earlier and then I did not follow it up. Okay. So let me follow it up again tomorrow. And I have downloaded all the lectures, so you can remove those. Okay, so yeah. Please go ahead. Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah, thanks a lot. Okay. See you everyone next week.